Okay. Over the next hour, I'd like to talk a little bit about fracking, of course, but I want to put it in some context. And where I'd like to start in doing that is to tell you a little bit about where I'm coming from. I read this book when I was 21 years old. The year was 1972. The book had just been published. It was a huge seller. It has been, up to this point, the best-selling environmental book so far, The Limits to Growth. It was the report of a study, a computer modeling study, of the likely interactions between population growth, resource depletion, and environmental impacts. It was the first time anybody had tried to do this. And they came to some rather startling conclusions. Their standard run scenario, which was basically just projecting forward into time the existing trends, showed a peak in decline in world industrial output sometime in the first half of the 21st century. The other scenarios tried to tweak those input variables in different ways, showing government policies to reduce population growth and consumption, to restrain environmental impacts, and so on. And all of these efforts simply led to a delaying of the peak and decline. So the idea that there were limits to world economic growth was an unwelcome one in certain quarters, and so this book was widely derided, especially by mainstream economists. But in recent years, the Commonwealth Scientific and Industrial Research Organization in Australia, which is Australia's main scientific research institution, has done a retrospective analysis of the Limits to Growth study from 1972 and came to this conclusion that the standard run or most pessimistic of the scenarios was actually closest to modeling the evolution of the different variables over time. So the good news is we're right on track. But how these limits to world growth are approaching is perhaps a bit different than what was envisioned back in the early 1970s. And I think we can safely say at this point that it's mostly about energy in one way or another. So a little bit about energy. It's really important. In fact, it's the essence of life, and it's certainly the essence of our economy. Most mainstream economists would say, well, energy is 10% of GDP. So if oil prices go up, or if energy is constrained in other ways, then we have at most a 10% hit on GDP. That's a very narrow way of thinking about energy, because in fact, of course, if the lights go out and there's no gasoline at the pumps, the economy doesn't decline by 10%. The economy goes away. It's 100% dependent on energy. We've been using energy forever, for at least as long as we've been human, actually as long as we've been biological organisms. And up until recent times, the last couple of hundred years, we used it in renewable forms, mostly in the forms of food crops, animal muscles, human muscles. All of that changed with the Industrial Revolution. Fossil fuels were completely unprecedented in all of human economic history. Energy dense, inexpensive, portable. We were able to do things we could never have done previously. With a combination of fossil fuels and a few inventions. We saw massive expansion of manufacturing of consumer goods. Suddenly, we were able to replace human labor in all sorts of ways with machines. In agriculture, for example, prior to the Industrial Revolution, most people were farmers. And of course, this was again a main energy source for society, agriculture. And it took 70-80% of the population farming in order to produce enough of an energy surplus to fund, energy-wise, a small minority of the population to live in cities and specialize in other occupations, arts and crafts and soldiery and statecraft and all the rest. So suddenly, agriculture could be mechanized, freeing people up from the farms to move to cities, to engage in other occupations, to be newspaper editors or professors of medieval French literature, or, you know, thousands and thousands of occupations. This was the birth of the middle class, really. Manufacturing of labor-saving machinery in the form of vacuum cleaners and dishwashers and all the rest freed up half the population, women, to move out of the home into the workforce. Not a lot. Not move out of the home, but to join the workforce. It's magical when you think about it. You know, nature did all the work of making fossil fuels. All we've had to do is dig down into the earth and free them up and burn them. If you've ever run out of gasoline in your car and had to push it a few feet off to the side of the road, you know how much work that is. Well, imagine pushing your car 20 or 30 miles. Sorry, I'm using U.S. metrics here. That's really a lot of work, but we get that done for us with a single U.S. gallon of gasoline for which we in California are paying $4 and complaining. So 6 or 8 weeks of hard human labor, which is what it would take to push that car for 20, 30 miles, we're getting for $4. That's incredibly cheap energy, and that's what has driven economic growth just over the last century or two. You know, previous centuries, civilizations were rising and falling, but daily life was pretty much the same from generation to generation for most people. All of that has changed profoundly. And we see the close correlation between GDP growth, energy consumption, and carbon emissions. Well, for all their economic benefits, there are a couple of serious problems with fossil fuels, one of which, of course, is that burning them is changing the climate, and changing the climate in ways that are not very favorable for the continuation of industrial society or human civilization in any form. From a policy standpoint, the world has pretty much accepted 2 degrees of warming as just fine and dandy, regardless of the fact that 1 degree of warming so far has led to extreme weather events, which in turn impact agriculture as well as other aspects of the economy. But are we really just on track for 2 degrees of warming? It may be that we are setting off self-reinforcing feedbacks that even with 450 parts per million of CO2, which is the current policy target, if you will, could produce much higher degrees of warming. One of these feedbacks is the melting of Arctic tundra and methane hydrates. Methane, of course, is a much more powerful greenhouse gas, a more potent greenhouse gas than CO2. So as methane is released from the Arctic soils and waters, that drives even faster warming, which melts even more methane, releases even more methane. And so, again, a self-reinforcing feedback loop. And there's a lot of methane stored in the Arctic. Also, as the Arctic warms, the North Polar ice cap is melting. Now, the North Polar ice cap reflects a lot of the sun's rays, but as it melts, that opens up dark ocean water to absorb more heat from the sun, which causes the polar ice cap to melt even faster. Again, a self-reinforcing feedback. So are we on target or on track for 2 degrees of warming, or 4 or 6? No one knows at this point, but the indications are that the IPCC scenarios are too conservative. The climate sensitivity to increased increments of CO2 forcing, the climate sensitivity is greater than has been previously estimated. This is the emerging consensus among climate scientists. If this is the case, if we are headed to 4 or 6 degrees or more of warming, just with the amount of CO2 that has been emitted so far and is almost certain to be emitted in the next 20 to 40 years, then we're in a pickle. But this is not the only problem with fossil fuels. There's also the problem that these are finite resources. And we've always known that in principle, but the assumption generally has been that this won't be a difficulty anytime soon. You know, maybe for future generations, decades and decades from now, there might be the problem of running out of one fossil fuel or another, but certainly not in our lifetimes. Well, no, we're not going to run out of any fossil fuel in our lifetimes or ever. I'll explain why in a little while. But that doesn't mean that the fact that these fuels are non-renewable and finite and depleting isn't a problem. We're seeing this first and foremost with oil, which is in many ways the economically pivotal fossil fuel. Why? Because we use it for transportation and it represents 95% of transport energy, roughly speaking. Transportation is key to trade, and trade is key to the economy as a whole. So really, oil is the most essential of all energy sources from the standpoint of our economy. What's actually been happening with world oil production? Well, it had been on a steady upward track since we started using it back in the 1860s. With one major hiccup back in the 1970s and early 80s, when there were political interruptions to the global oil supply, the oil shocks of the early 1970s and 79, the Iranian Revolution later on, and the earlier embargo of instigated by the OPEC countries. But other than those instances, oil supply has grown at a pretty rapid and steady pace right up until about 2005. And for some reason, since 2005, the global oil supply has not grown nearly as quickly. Largely because the supply hasn't been growing, we've seen oil prices rise really dramatically.